Sunday Baroque Conversations is made possible by the Friends of Sunday Baroque and is produced at WSHU Public Radio in Fairfield, Connecticut. I'm Suzanne Bona. Thanks for listening. Don't miss an episode of Sunday Baroque Conversations. Subscribe on Apple, Google, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. And please leave us a review. If you want to find out where you can listen to our weekly show, visit our website, sundaybaroque.org, for a station list and our 24/7 stream. Again, that's sundaybaroque.org. Lauren Rico is an award-winning American author and a classical music broadcaster. The native New Yorker's fictional characters are often musicians and living in the world of classical music, such as the brilliant young pianists who are the protagonists in her 2023 book Counterpoint, and the talented cellist who's the central character in her 2016 book Rhapsody. Lauren's also a longtime radio colleague and a personal friend, and she joins me on Zoom to talk about where she gets her inspiration as a writer. Hi, Lauren. So happy to chat with you.
Hi. This is really fun to be here on this side of the microphone.
Yeah. So first of all, you came to writing after having a long and successful career that is still going on in broadcasting. What inspired you to make that leap?
You know, actually, it kind of came out of a very dark time. My mother passed in 2012 unexpectedly. And then 4 months later, I had a cancer diagnosis. And I suffer from chronic depression. And it put me in such a dark place for probably a good 2 years. Mm. And I had a really great therapist who encouraged me to try different things to see if I could get out of my head. And I was having a particularly bad time of it. I was back in North Carolina where my mother lived, getting some things from her house. And I was having a little meltdown and I called him. He said, you know what? You need to get out of your hotel room. Just go sit in a coffee shop somewhere. Sit down and write. He said, you like to write, write something. So I started writing and then I did not stop. Hmm. I didn't stop. I wrote a book. And when I was done with that, I wrote two more. It was a trilogy. Hmm. And I just kind of kept going. I like to joke that I'm like those sharks that have to keep moving all the time to keep the oxygenated water going over their gills. Mm-hmm. I keep moving, keep writing to keep, you know, the depression at bay, keep my head clear. Mm-hmm. And it's been just, I had no idea I was any good at it. Mm-hmm. And it just, it was never anything, actually it was something my mother had wanted to do. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of fitting that, that it came out of that part of my life, but, I love it. It's one of those things where I'm in the middle of it going, oh, will this never end? This is so hard. I hate this. And then it's done. And I'm like, can we do it again?
Yeah.
A roller coaster.
Yeah. So interestingly, that's a little bit for some people in some situations, like being a classical musician, right? You know, you start to play a new piece and it's really hard and you think, I can't do this. And then, you know, you sort of little by little do it. And then all of a sudden you go, wow, you know, this feels great. And you perform it and you get this feedback. So, but I do want to ask you how you decided to use classical music as a vehicle for your fiction. You know, was it a logical choice because of your experience as a musician, as a broadcaster, or, you know, did you consider other settings or did this just sort of naturally fall into place?
Yeah, this just kind of, it just fell into place. I don't know where this particular story came from. Well, actually I do. It's the Reverie trilogy. It's Reverie, Rhapsody and Requiem. And it was kind of born out of a grudge I've always held for the male French horn players I had to deal with, you know, growing up, junior high school, college. Mm-hmm. Some of them were very obnoxious. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, I'll get them. So I made a sociopath French horn player as my antagonist and just had a tremendous amount of fun. But it was, I mean, classical music's what I know. Mm-hmm. And for a while there, I'd say, you know, I want to put the sexy back in Bach. I had this idea that I could somehow reach people who wouldn't go out of their way to listen to classical music. But if I could tie classical music up into this unexpected kind of page turner, steamy bow, that it might get them to be interested. You know, any book of mine that has music in it, a musician character, has a front page that says the music of whatever book it is, Reverie, Rhapsody, Counterpoint. Mm-hmm. And you know, with a message to the reader saying, you know, this is the playlist. And as you hear me mention these pieces, you might find it adds a whole other dimension.
Yeah.
If you'll stop and listen to it. And I would curate playlists on Spotify, you know, and it was really nice. I'd have people say, I had no idea. And then, you know, you wrote it so beautifully. I wanted to hear it. I felt like I could hear it. Mm-hmm. And it started this whole thing. You know, there are no words for music, really. I mean, there are lyrics, of course, you know, but there's no language to speak about music. There's nothing I can say to you unless we're both musicologists mm-hmm. and we have perfect pitch. There really aren't any words for me to describe a piece of music mm-hmm. that so that you'll be able in your head to hear it. You know, without humming it, without lyrics, without anything. It's, you know, think about, you know, the opening of Beethoven's Fifth or something. It's just, it's pretty impossible, very difficult. And I sometimes speak to other writers about, you know, don't be afraid to put music in your books because there are ways to talk about it, right. You know, by comparing it to other things like a sport, by thinking, you know, trying to capture what the musician looks like when he or she is playing, mm-hmm. Or just conjuring different images to go with the music, things that I myself kind of would hear when I listen to them. I would go online and watch videos of Yo-Yo Ma. And I totally, there's one scene in, I think it's Reverie, where Julia, the cellist, she's had this terrible thing happen and she has to play on stage. She's doing this encore. And I watched this video of Yo-Yo Ma playing the swan, and the way he held the cello, the way he looked towards the sky, all this stuff. I took it all, mm-hmm. gave it all to my character, because it just fits so beautifully.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was just a long way of saying, yeah, music just, it was the thing. It was the thing, but it made it very difficult for me career-wise. When I decided I wanted to try and get published, it was a very difficult sell because classical music is a hard sell. It really is, unfortunately.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say too, you know, that was a really interesting description or really interesting connections that you just made about how to describe music. And the really great companion to have that playlist. But there are, I mean, classical music, and we know this as broadcasters, there are all of these code words and there are all of these arcane sort of traditions. And it's almost like you have to have sort of the secret handshake or the secret knock to be able to, you know, to be allowed into the club. And that's, and I say that that's not a good thing. I don't think that that's a club we should have. I think that it's important.
And I think that was what it was like when you and I came into classical broadcasting. You know, we were at the very tail end of that, I believe, when it was still very, and now we turn to the music of Beethoven. You know, just that very reverent, you should be kissing the ground that these people walked on.
Right.
And we're not good enough. We're not worthy. And if you have to ask what it is, you don't deserve to listen to it.
Exactly. You know, exactly.
Obnoxious. And that's where I think broadcasters like you and myself and say Kate Remington and a lot of the broadcasters today have gone, thankfully, in a totally other direction. You know, we're companions and we're kind of like escorting people through and the ones saying, hey, no, it's okay. You don't have to know it. Right. All you have to know is that it speaks to you, that you like it, that it touches some part of you. You don't have to know the keys. You don't even have to know who wrote it or what the instruments are. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
Right.
If it speaks to you, that's what the composer wanted. That's what it was.
Right. Right. And I think too, it's very easy to get bogged down in some of the, again, the language, the traditions and whatnot. I have to say, I don't want to veer too far off topic, but I don't know if you saw the movie Tar. Did you see?
I did. Yes.
So I found myself, I don't even want to get into the whole message or whatever, because that's sort of a separate thing. But like, I found myself, particularly at the very beginning where Cate Blanchett's being interviewed and she is riffing on all of this insider stuff. And I kept finding myself thinking, if I didn't know already what she was talking about, I would have turned this off in frustration because it made no sense. She was referencing iconic musicians, Bernstein and, you know, and iconic music and her interaction with it and her training. But I thought to myself, if one were not already steeped in the classical music tradition, this would make no sense.
No, and I thought that Cate Blanchett pulled it off beautifully, because I believed, I believed that she knew Bernstein. I believed that she, you know, with Lenny,
Right. But you knew who he was. And if you were someone who knew who Leonard Bernstein was, it would be like, who, what? It was sort of establishing her credentials, I think, and her pedigree, but only if you already knew what the pedigree meant. So I say this by way of saying that I think you do a really, really good job of boiling it down in a way that is understandable to a layman, just as you do on the air, because it's not something that is, nobody's born knowing these things. You learn it because you live it, or it's your job, or it's your passion. But if it's not your passion, you can still read your books and appreciate it.
Yeah. That's what I hope. You know, that's it. You know, I've always been of the mind that classical music is for everybody. And I've just abhorred this. And I've worked with enough people who are holdovers to that past generation who consider me to be a classical music lightweight because of my presentation. And I just don't care. Mm-hmm. don't care. If one person enjoys something I've said, or hears it differently, I think that's what it is. In presenting the on-air stuff, I feel like my goal is to like get these composers off the dusty pedestal and, you know, they're these one-dimensional dead, mostly white guys, and you know, kind of breathe some life back into them and let people see they were real human beings with real problems, not unlike the ones that we have today. You know, they were human, they weren't gods, they were exceptionally talented, but you know, they were human beings like the rest of us. And so if I can tell a story or find a way to talk about a piece of music so that somebody hears it differently, that's what I hope to accomplish, you know, as a host. With the writing, again, it's like, if I can just open that door just a crack to classical music, because people, I know there are a lot of people who do like to listen to music when they read, and if they, you know, listen to a play, I think it'll I write music like it's a character in the book. It's a character, or maybe a scene, like an actual physical place. It's part of the atmosphere, the ambiance. You know, those three books, especially the first three, the Reverie trilogy, there's a darkness to all of the music that I program in it, too, that I program, that I write about that it's meant to kind of underscore, you know, what's happening with these characters. It would be the film score, you know, it would be that theme, that creepy theme. Oh no, something's going to happen now. Oh no, run, Julia, run.
Yeah. So you mentioned the, rough outline of the not so great French horn players. I don't know if that was a particular person, but have you ever had anyone say, hey, did you write that about me?
No. And it's funny because one of the horn players I had been thinking of mainly, we kind of touched base again recently on Facebook, and it was just like, oh, he's a really nice guy.
Good.
I was an obnoxious teenager. We were obnoxious teenagers, you know, and I'm sure he did and said some things that were obnoxious, but I certainly did my, we were like I said, 13, 14, 15, 16. And, you know, here, what it comes down to is this, I was a really mediocre horn player, at best a mediocre horn player. And it's something I could look at as an adult and say, oh yeah, no, I never should have been. I mean, it was fun. Don't regret any of it. I maybe should not have pursued it as long as I did, like through grad school. Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't very good. And so I think I knew that I was very insecure because I couldn't play as well as everybody else. So I think I was very sensitive about that growing up. So musicians were sensitive anyway.
I know. So as a reader, what are some of your favorite genres or books or authors?
You know, I'm a big fan of women's fiction, which is the direction I'm going in now. I moved into general romance there because romance is, it's funny because I don't read it, but if we're writing it, it's very formulaic, for lack of a better word. And I know that doesn't sound like a good thing, but it's very, you've probably heard of the meet cute, which is how the couple meets, you know, and then there's a dark moment when all is lost, seems like all is lost. And then there's a grand gesture for the HEA, the happily ever after, or the happily for now. You know, so it when you have the structure there, it makes it easy to just kind of fill in the blanks. You know what it makes me think of actually is, I remember reading that that's how Mozart learned orchestration, that he would take piano sonatas from other composers, and he would write orchestral parts. So the piano line was there already. He didn't have to worry about the melody. Mm-hmm. So here in A Romance, I've got the whole framework for it. I just had to flesh it out. Mm-hmm. And that's what Mozart did. All he had to do was work around what he had until he was comfortable doing it himself. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the way I imagined myself when I first started writing, especially romance. And then it got to a point where I was, that same thing that attracted me started to become, I wouldn't say problematic, but I was ready to break the mold. Mm-hmm. You know, I was ready to break the form. And that's when women's fiction came in, because that's doesn't necessarily have to have a romantic element in it, but it's like a woman's journey. And these days that would be like Leanne Moriarty, Nine Perfect Strangers, Kristen Higgins, The Four Winds. And she did the one that was just on Netflix, Firefly Lane, things like that. You know, so it's about a woman's journey. So that's I'm, in fact, my debut novel, Familia, is women's fiction, my debut women's fiction novel. And that's coming out the end of the year. So it's been really fun to go in that direction. And I'm already working on the next one, the follow-up to that, which will be musicians again. Mm-hmm. I'm writing that one right now. And I've got, a cellist and a pianist, and it's a whole mystery. So
So I'm glad that you brought up Familia, because that was one of my next questions. Could you give us a little preview of that?
Sure. Familia is it starts 25 years ago. A baby is snatched off the streets of San Juan, Puerto Rico, right out of her stroller, 7-month-old. And her sister is 5 years old at the time. And her sister spends the next 25 years trying to find out what happened to her sister. Meanwhile, in New York City, a young woman, she's a fact checker for a major magazine in New York City, and her parents have recently died. And as part of a work assignment, she signs up for one of these ancestry DNA things that her editor is hoping that somebody in the office will have some kind of genetic mystery that they can write about. And as soon as she, you know, signs up and everything, she gets contacted by someone who's a genetic match, who says, I think you're my sister, you know, and because it's a 50% genetic match, which is a full sibling. And, you know, the woman in New York City, Gabby, she says, I wasn't adopted. I certainly wasn't kidnapped. Unfortunately, my parents aren't here to prove that to you. Eventually she decides she'll go to Puerto Rico, and she says, you know what? I'm not your sister, but I chase facts, and you follow the facts, you'll find the truth, and I will help you figure out what happened so you get some closure. And that's what happens for a week. The two of them kind of, the story goes back and forth 25 years over the course of one day, from the time the baby disappears to the time the story is resolved, they're going back and forth from present day to that one single day. So little by little through different characters, you're kind of getting bits and pieces. And I think I wrote it in such a way that you finish one chapter and go, oh my gosh, is the baby dead? You know, oh my gosh, did he sell the baby? Oh my gosh, what happened? Is the baby alive? You know, every 5 minutes, you know, it's a new theory. Yeah. And you don't know till the very end. There are twists and turns coming until the very, very last. But they were twisty to me. I was writing and going, oh my God, is that what happens? You know? Wow. What? No.
Wow. So very much not formulaic like the romance novel.
No, but it's like the characters will often reveal themselves to me. They will, things will, as I'm writing the last lines, things come to me that I hadn't thought about the entire process of writing the book. And that's what happened with this last one. Probably the biggest twist of all, when I was writing those last lines, it came to me. And I remember my agent reading it. She's like, wait, what? Where did this come from? This wasn't there yesterday. I'm like, I know it wasn't. but it's been great fun. And that flexibility to do a dual timeline, go back and forth, and tell it in whatever point of view I want, in whatever format I want. You know, do I want it to be all text messages? Do I want it to be letters? You can do anything. It's just this whole world building thing. And I'm Puerto Rican and Cuban and Italian, but there's this movement right now, and you know, we see it in classical music too, where everybody's trying hard to be more diverse, to be more aware, and to be more inclusive of, you know, cultures that haven't had enough exposure, you know, in the mainstream of classical music and television and films and writing. Mm-hmm. And there's something called own voices, hashtag own voices, in publishing. And it is authors of specific ethnicities or specific experiences. It could be an LGBTQ writing about those experiences. Mm. And it helps that I am this nationality, and there aren't many stories written in Puerto Rico. And, you know, so I was uniquely poised to tell this story. And it was, an epiphany for me as well. I realized that every time I'd gone there, I'd gone as a tourist, you know, brought a friend, brought a boyfriend. I'd looked at Puerto Rico as a place to go and hang on the beach and eat, you know, drink pina coladas and eat good food. The last time I went back with my husband, actually I'd already written Familia. We went back and it was a whole other thing. It's like, I did a DNA ancestry test and my roots go back 67 generations.
Wow.
To Puerto Rico, to the, you know, the indigenous Taino people. So I've got a long history there.
Wow. So you said early in our conversation that your start in writing was inspired at least in part by a dark place, a dark time in your life,
sure,
with some tragedies,
yeah,
and some sadnesses. And it was, I assume it was implied in your saying that it was at least in some measure therapy.
Oh, absolutely.
Is writing still therapy now that it's kind of a job, if you will? And if it is your book writing, your professional writing, still your therapy, or do you still write sort of separately for your own therapeutic benefit?
I love to write. I will always write. And it doesn't feel like work. I'm hoping that it will be, so to speak, my second chapter. You know, I'm 33 years in broadcasting now. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's been a long haul, and I could do it indefinitely, and I hope to keep my hands in it for some time to come. But the writing is like that new kind of excitement and joy that I had when I first started my career, you know, in radio, like, oh, where can I go? It's always like, I'm always looking for the next thing, the next level to hit, it wasn't enough for me to just write the book and have that catharsis and feel better. You know, it was like, how do I get an agent? How do I get published? How do I get a better agent? How do I get a better publisher? How do I become a New York Times bestseller? It's never enough. Next. I think that's part of my therapy too. I am obnoxiously optimistic, and it's like, go big or go home. So I love it, and I feel propelled by it. And I hope to be doing it for the rest of my life to some extent. You know, I think this will be my retirement. I hope it will be my retirement. So we'll see. We'll see how that works. But the radio work is so flexible that it's, you know, I can do both. I can absolutely do both. Yeah. And unfortunately, they're different audiences usually, so I can't really cross promote. The women's fiction will be better. I don't go so far as to promote the romances, because they're definitely not everybody's cup of tea, and some of them are quite steamy. And I'm careful to let people know that. I don't want them to be shocked or think less of me because I wrote steamy stuff. but yeah, it still makes me happy. It makes me very happy. And it still kind of keeps the depression. Depression's one of those things that if you have it, it's always going to be there in the background, like anxiety, it's white noise in the background. Mm-hmm. But the writing, I think it helps me to get out of my head and into somebody else's head and somebody else's world enough that I can, you know, have a breather and also I work out my own issues. There's a bit of me in every single book. Every single book, an issue, a thing, a person, I'm in every single one of them. So I'm like working out my own problems right there on the page, which is, it's kind of an odd thing to do. But it's great fun. It's really great fun.
Oh, may it always be so.
I mean, I'm hoping now to write After this, oh God, I have a lot of ideas, so I have a long list of things. But I do have an idea for a classical music radio DJ story. So those two worlds will collide at some point in time. But I'm looking forward to the next one. Will be Turista, and that is going to it's going to have kind of echoes of Pablo Casals in it, because Pablo Casals adopted Puerto Rico as his homeland. You know, the great cellist, he married one of his students who was quite young, like 60 years younger than him at the time. And my grandmother tells the story. They lived in Ceiba, where my grandmother grew up. And she told the story of how his young wife would push him around town in his wheelchair. They called him El Maestro. And you know, he launched the Casals Festival down there, and really brought, they didn't have a symphony in Puerto Rico. You know, he kind of brought this whole element of classical music. He loved it there. And they would just see him, you know, around town. And she said, oh, she took such good care of him. Wow. You know, this young woman, she was so devoted to him. Yeah. And she's still around. She went on to marry Eugenie Stoman. Oh. And she is running. What is she running now? She's running something big that I can't remember now. Marta Stoman, Casals Stoman. But yeah, it's, you know, but this one, I've got my cellist guy. It's going to be that, you know, that like Dateline Friday night thing, you know, the couple newlyweds on the cruise and the husband goes missing. Did she push him overboard? It's going to be one of those things that, you know, it's going to be a mystery. And he's a cellist, you know, he'll pop up playing somewhere like 30 years later, and it's all tied together. And there's a big, yeah. So this music will be a big thread through it, just because I love to write music and it's something I do well. So, and I think it's something also that kind of puts me, it makes me stand out from some of my colleagues in the genre. So I'm hoping to do more of that. We'll see.
Cool. I've been speaking with Lauren Rico, the award-winning American author and classical music broadcaster, and my friend and colleague on Zoom. Thank you so much, and good luck.
Oh, thank you so much. It's been great fun. Thank you.